Steven, will you grab the lights for us, please? All right. We are into our graphing. Okay? So, we have been factoring quadratics, which is x squared, aka polynomials. We have found the solutions, which was, that was where it would become zero, right? So we're going to start tying things more and more together with the graphing. Don't let this graphing goof with you. It really is something, if you take your time and pay attention to it, you're going to get it. Okay? And I've talked about this before, but things that deal with, in the real world, quadratics, one would be breaking distance. One would be free fall, like if you throw something. One would be, even if you just were to throw a football or a baseball or soccer, kick a soccer ball, I guess you could throw a soccer ball too. And I understand, Rob, you can kick a football, so. I just needed to head that one off real quick. Oh, you can head a soccer ball too. Nothing like heading to baseball, especially on that line drive. So there's a lot of things in life that deal with quadrants. A lot. He's not in trouble. I'm just trying to head off all
no,
of those things.
I'm talking like, about something that happened one day.
All right, item number one, are these three problems up here, are they linear or are they quadratics? What makes them linear? Y equals mx plus b. So what value makes it linear? The x, and it's x raised to the first power. So if you have x by itself, that means it's going to be a linear situation. Okay, so someone talk me through it. What do I do on this problem? What's the first thing I plot? Go to -5 in the x or the y direction. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, and from that point, I'm going to use the slope. So I'm going to go up 2 and over 1. And that forms us our nice straight line, yes? Well, don't judge. I know. I'll try better the next time. All right. Problem number two. How do we solve problem number two? What fancy technique have we learned on number two? Other than ROM.
The cover
method. All right. So if I cover up that right there, I get 3x equals 12. So 3 times x equals 12. So x equals
4.
So on the x direction, I go 1, 2, 3, and 4. And then cover this. I have -4 times y gives me 12.
-3.
And then, okay, I'll do better this time. Here we go. Close.
I'm trying.
Why don't you just
third?
Because then it starts doing a snap too.
All right. Third way is sometimes a little tougher to look at. Any idea how
distribute.
We graph the first?
Distribute. Minus one.
So let me ask you all this. What? Hang on. Before you start jumping too much. What do you feel, just by looking at this, rather than distributing and all that kind of stuff, what do you feel the slope would be of this equation?
-3x.
Okay, so -3 would be the slope, right? Okay.
True that.
Now, this is actually called point slope. So there is a point that we establish. Okay? So we're going to get our points from here and from here. So in the world of math, when you're getting a point, It's always opposite of what you think. So you have a point of 4, opposite of what you think. So that's our x value. It's opposite of what you think. So what do you think our y value would be? If
-1.
Okay, so it's always opposite of what you think, especially when it's grouped together.
We did.
So I'm just trying to bring this back. So 4, -1. And then I go from that. Remember, no matter what point I have, I just need to figure out a second point. So from here, I'm going to go down 3. 3/1. Okay.
You don't like it.
We got videos on it if you need to go back and look at them. All right, so those are a few things. So we'll use some more of those as warm-ups later and see how we do. So as far as that goes, do you feel good on at least 2 out of 3?
Yeah.
Okay. So you could have, on that last one, distributed the -3 and then subtracted the 1, and it would have worked out very nicely for you as well. Okay? Let's see if there's anything more. Nothing more. Can I move off this screen?
Yeah.
All right. So quadratic, general form is y equals ax squared plus bx plus c, where a, b, and c are any numbers you want them to be. Okay? The graph looks like that over the side. It's called a parabola. Parabolas open up or down. Just let's eliminate the question. You in high school will not see parabolas open side and side. They can, but they don't. Not in high school. Okay? When you get to calculus, you'll see them open side to side. Okay? So the graph of a parabola. So for the most part, right now, all we really need to know about parabolas is they open up and down. They are in standard form as ax squared plus bx plus c, again, where a, b, and c are whatever number you want. So the graph is a parabola. Okay? So a few things let's define. The parabola, you have a vertex. It's either the very bottom point or the very top point. It's the very bottom point if the parabola opens up. It's the very top point if the parabola opens down. Does that language make okay? So if I had this versus if I had this, obviously one's opening up, one's opening down. This would be a vertex, and this would be a vertex. Okay? So on the one on the left, the vertex is the very bottommost point. The one on the right that's opening down is the very topmost point. So we'll just box that in green, so that indicates that up there. The axis of symmetry, they call it a fancy word. You know what the axis of symmetry is? It's a mirror. It's a mirror, like what you look into. Now let's talk about what a mirror does. When you look into a mirror, you are seeing an image of yourself. Agreed? Okay, how far behind that mirror is the image of you? How far behind the mirror is that image of you?
The axis of symmetry.
Well, the axis of symmetry is the mirror.
Time out.
So, Gentry.
This is
Gentry, you look into a mirror.
Okay.
Gentry's looking into a mirror. I know it doesn't appear that he does ever, but he's... I'm sorry, Gentry. Gentry, you're still looking into a mirror. Okay? So, if Gentry were to look into a mirror, and Gentry were to be standing 3 feet away from the mirror that he's looking into... If Gentry were to say, okay, my nose is 3 feet away from this mirror, that means that the image in the mirror, the nose would be 3 feet behind that.
It was 6 feet.
So there'd be a distance of 6 feet. Okay, so the middle part is the mirror, right? So the axis of symmetry does this. The axis of symmetry, we'll make this purple. All it is a vertical line, and we make it kind of dotted. It goes right through the vertex. And it just says, hey, the point over here is the same distance as it is over here. The point over here, so on and so forth. Okay? The axis of symmetry is the line goes through the vertex and it divides the graph in half. It's a mirror. That's all it is. It doesn't define the graph. It's just a mirror. The y-intercept is the point at which x is equal to 0. If the vertex is not at x equals 0, then there's another point with the same y value on it as the other side of the axis of symmetry. So we'll talk about that quite a bit. So the y-intercept would be, if you had your xy axis, would be this point. Okay, that point can be, it can be the vertex. It can have the axis of symmetry go through it, or it could be shifted on either side. And then the roots are the points where the parabola crosses the x-axis. So you have the x-axis is the horizontal. These are the roots. Okay? Now, things about where it crosses the x-axis. It can cross at an exact whole number. It can cross at a fraction. It can cross at a decimal. It can cross at any rational point, and it can cross at any irrational point. Does anyone recall what an irrational number would be? Do what? Yeah, number that you can't make a fraction. So is 0.25 irrational? No, 0.25 is 1/4. Agreed? But if you were to take, say, oh, I don't know, let's go with the obvious one of pi, 3.14159, it goes on and on and on forever and ever and ever. That can't be written as a fraction. Now, before you want to argue it, say, no, my elementary school teacher said 22 over 7 is pi. Your elementary school teacher did not discover the fraction that went along with pi. Okay? Pi does not, is an irrational number. It does not have, cannot be a fraction. Why do we use 22 sevens as it, or sometimes? Because it's a close fraction value to what pi is. Okay, but it's not exact. You've never seen 22 over 7?
No, I've
never. If you go 22 divided by 7 on a calculator, anyone have a calculator out?
You lost him as soon as you said hello to class.
It happens, but we love him anyhow. So someone go 22 divided by 7 and tell me what you get. 3.14285. 3.1428. Okay, that's pretty close to 3.14159. Right? So 22 over 7 is a very close approximate value of pi. It's not the exact value of pi. So sometimes in elementary school, they like to throw that at you, and then all of a sudden you think you're all grown up and you know, you've learned how the master of mathematics is. So, all right, so tell us, okay, so f at x means the same thing as what? It's the same thing as y, right? So this means the same thing as y, so we could add y equals, it's going to be the same thing, it's just functional notation versus not. A, our very first value here, this a value here, this will tell us if the parabola opens up or down. Okay, if it's positive, the parabola opens up. If it's negative, the parabola opens down. So if we had y equals negative 7x squared, whatever else, the a value is negative 7, that means that the parabola opened down. If I had y equals 10,000x squared, 10,000 is positive, so the parabola opens upward. Okay, that a value dictates how fast it will grow in the positive or the negative direction. So A, if it's bigger than 0, so if it's a positive number, then it's going to open up. If A is here and it's a negative number, it's going to open down. So the parabolas will look like that or that, depending upon that. Does that make sense? So a lot of times when we start getting into the parabolas, the first thing I'll ask is, hey, does the parabola open up or down? And you'll have to tell me if it opens up or down. I'll say, how do you know? And then when I say, how do you know? You'll say, because the A value is, and then give me whatever the value is. Does that make sense? So we'll refer to it there. The vertex can be found here. So this finds me the X component of the vertex. What does it look like you're missing as far as the vertex? The vertex is a point. So the vertex is a point. So if it is a point, you have an x and a y value that go with it. Okay, in order to find the vertex, you can start using x equals negative b over 2a. That finds you which value, would you think, x or y? X. So once you find x, you plug it back in, and you can find y to get out. We will be working with that a lot. The y-intercept can work once you go and you plug 0 into the x's, so the x squared in this. So this right here, if it's in standard form, really tells you the y-intercept. So we'll put a little addendum here. If in standard form, so remember standard form is descending out order. We don't have any parentheses that are grouping things together. And if it's in standard form, the point 0, comma, C is our vertex. Notice where the C stands. So if it's in standard form, meaning it's not grouped together, it's not factored out, if it's all foiled out, the C value, 0, comma, C, will tell you where it crosses the y-axis. And then the roots can be found by setting our y value. So in our case up here, our f at x value equal to 0. Okay? So this is what we just got done working on. This was the last part of the unit. This is where you took the grouping parts of your parentheses and set them equal to 0. So remember, we had talked about going, oh, this factors down to x plus 3 and x minus 7. So let's take x plus 3, set it equal to 0. Take x minus 7, set it equal to 0. You find the two places where those are our roots. But these are all things that we are going to work on. And I really, if you pay attention and you try, you truly try, you're going to get there. The axis of symmetry is the line with the equation x equals negative b over 2a. Notice the vertex and the axis of symmetry. Ram, what do you got?
So what's the vertex? That only comes with the x. So how do you find the y?
You plug that value back in.
Oh.
Okay, to the x. And that will find you the function at x or y, depending on the function. Okay. So what do you notice about the vertex, how we have it labeled there, and the axis of symmetry? It's the same. The axis of symmetry is a straight line. The axis of symmetry is x equals a number. X equals a number is what kind of straight line?
Vertical.
A vertical straight line does not have a slope that's defined as an undefined slope because it approaches infinity, which means it's undefined. Okay, so that's kind of the basics. Now, if you're kind of going, I'm not here yet. What I can do is we will refer back to this and see if we can start going through. So Ram had said, hey, we have that. What we have to do is once we know what this value is, we have to plug it back in. So our point is actually negative b over 2a, and then plug in. That's how we get our x and y value for our vertex. But we'll keep working with it. I will keep trying to have consistency every time we go through the problem. So I want that consistency to relate to how would you go through a test or quiz using that being consistent, the same type of questions every time. Okay? So, let's move on. Oh, we're voting. Good. All right. Graphing quadratic equations. Find the x-coordinate of the vertex using negative b over 2a. Draw in the axis of symmetry, so you're drawing in your vertical line. Make a table of values to the left and to the right of the vertex. Find the y-intercept and the other points, its reflection, other point, its reflection, if possible. Plot the points and connect with a smooth curve to form a parabola. Find the roots if possible. Okay? That's an awful lot to think about. Let's go through it slowly. Okay. Very first thing it said to do on that last slide is find the x-coordinate of the vertex. Is that okay? We're going to use negative b over 2a. All right, item number one, do you feel this parabola opens up or down? Up. Why? What's positive? Which value?
The a value.
The a value is positive. What is my a value right now up there? X squared. One. It's not x squared, it's the one in front of it. Make sense? It's all right. Okay, so we have to realize that we do have a one that's out front. If there's not a number sitting there, it's got to be a one. Okay, what's my b value? Two. And what's my c value? -3. Okay, let's figure out the x component of my vertex. So I want to go negative b over 2a. So help me out. This negative comes along for the ride. If we have a second negative, then it becomes positive. Okay, so what's my b value? -2 over, that 2 is constant. What's my a value? Okay, so I get -2 over 2 times 1, so I get -2 over 2, which is -1. This is going to be the x component of my vertex. Okay, so I'm going to plug that in right here. Okay, a parabola, remember we said we have a mirror image. So we want two values to the right and two values to the left. If you do it appropriately, you only have to do the work of half of it to get there. Okay, so I'm going to ask this. As far as the number line goes, give me a number, one number to the left of -1, to the left.
-2.
-2, okay? Give me one number to the left of -2.
-3.
Give me one number to the right of -1.
Zero.
Give me one number to the right of 0. Okay? So I made the -1 right in the middle of it because I know it's going to be my vertex. So what this means right now is my axis of symmetry is this. So the line x equals negative x, that. So -1's here. So I'm going to do kind of a dotted line. And I'm going to go all the way up and all the way down. What did I say the axis of symmetry is like? Symmetrical. It's like a what?
Mirror.
So that means that if there's something on this side of it, there's going to be something on this side of it. Let me say that one more time. If there's something on this side of it, then there's something over on this side of it, and it's the same distance. Okay? So let's figure out what our vertex would be. Let's figure out what our vertex is going to be. I'm going to take -1, and I'm going to plug it in for my x values. Okay? So I have y equals -1 squared plus 2 times -1 minus 3. What is -1 squared? It's grouped, so what does it mean? Positive 1. Negative, or 2 times -1 is?
-2
minus 3. All right. 1 minus 2.
-1.
-1 minus 3.
-4.
Okay? The y component of my vertex is that. So at the point, -1, -4. So -1, -4. That's my vertex. Okay. I can find where it crosses the y-axis real easily. Where does it cross the y-axis? Yeah. Remember, where it crosses the y-axis is going to be at 0, comma, our c value. So our c value is what? -3. Because we got it from here. So it's 0, -3. 0, -3, right? Remember, the blue line is a mirror. So right on the other side of that, at the same horizontal part, I'm going to have another value. So what point is opposite of this? -2, what?
-2, -3.
All right, do I have a -2 up there in my x value? I have -2 up there in my x value. I do. So I have -2 there, so this becomes a -3. Do I have a 0 up there as a point in my x value? 0 what? through negative 3.
So is it 0 and negative 3 y-intercept, or is it negative 3?
This is my y-intercept. And this just happens to be the mirror image right on the other side of my axis of symmetry. At that point right there, at that instantaneous point, yes. Okay? All right, let's find, we have negative 3 and we have 1. Which one of these values seems easier to plug in up above?
1.
Now here's the nice thing. They are the same x distance away from the vertex. So both y values will be the same. So figure out which one's easier, and you all just told me 1's easier. So I have 1 squared plus 2 times 1 minus 3. So I get 1 plus 2 minus 3. 1 plus 2 is 3. 3 minus 3 is 0. If this is 0, let's see if this is going to work. I get right there. Then this has to be 0. Hang on. Why is this 0 over here? So look. It's a mirror image, right? So the distance here and the distance here are the exact same. This is our mirror. So at 0, I'm 2 away from the axis of symmetry. At 0, I'm 2 away from the axis of symmetry. Okay? Let's see. The y-intercept. We've just labeled that as y-intercept, so that's 0, negative 3. Okay? So once we have all that in place, let's do... There we go. Do you think there's more points up here and more points up here?
Yep.
Heck yeah, there's tons. They're infinite.
You have like 2 problems at the bottom.
Okay. Oh, there's further down?
Yeah.
Ask for some more stuff. Okay. Ooh, okay. I think by what we have up there, I think we can label the roots. Give me the roots as a point. Say that one more time. Negative 3 comma 0, and 1 comma 0. This is my root. This is my root. I can find the exact value as points. It's where a root is where it crosses the x-axis. What's the axis of symmetry? It's the equation x equals what? X equals negative 1.
Wait, so the axis of symmetry is always where the vertex is.
Say that one more time.
So the axis of symmetry is where the vertex is. It's where the x component of the vertex is.
So as soon as you find the vertex, you know the axis of symmetry just by looking at the x component of it. It's kind of a lot. Okay, this is like, woo, man. Dude, we got something curved now. Or different. Yeah.
So if you had like a problem, could you greatest common factor?
You could, yeah.
You
could. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. You don't have to, because the greatest common factor, your a value would be part of the negative b over 2a, which is part of the axis of symmetry. Okay.
Wait, are you always going to give us the standard form?
Well, if I don't, you could factor it back together, right? But we might have some other processes that might get us there. Like if you know, so let's take a look here. If I happen to know where it crosses here, what can you tell me about the axis of symmetry? It's halfway in between, right? That means that the vertex would be halfway in between them as well, right? So those are just a few things that we might start seeing. Can I move off this screen? Okay, so let's take a look. So this appears that it has a greatest common factor. We could go that way if you would like, but I don't think we should at this point. So let me ask you the first question. Does the parabola open up or down?
Down.
Why do you know it opens down?
Negative.
What's negative?
2.
The A value is negative. The A value is negative, the parabola opens down. Doesn't matter what all the rest of the sides are. If that's a negative right there, this means this bad boy's opening downward. Okay? I didn't factor anything out in order to answer that question. I just So right now you should kind of be visualizing, I have a parabola that's going to open down. So the vertex would be the highest point on this parabola. All right, so let's think about this. Let's think about this. I'm going to go negative b over 2a. What is negative b up there? Negative, what's my b value? 8. Does everyone feel comfortable with that? Times 2, 2 is a constant. What is my a value? Negative 2. Okay, so I'm going to get negative 8 over, what is 2 times negative 2? Negative 4. What negative over negative is? Positive. 8 over 4 is 2. So x, my x value is 2. So that right there is my axis of symmetry right away. So remember, the axis of symmetry is the mirror. It's a vertical line that we go on either side with. So x equals 2 is right here. And I'm just making this vertical line to show us we have a mirror. Okay? It's not really part of the graph. I'm just putting it into place as a guide. Okay? Do I have enough information to know the vertex? Well, I know the x component of the vertex. I don't know what the y component is. So I'm going to put the vertex here. 2, and then we'll plug it in and figure out something. All right, so now let's do this. Give me a number to the left of 2. 1. Give me a number to the left of 1. 0. Give me a number to the right of 2. Give me a number to the right of 3. Okay? Those are the values that we're going to start plugging in. So let's go ahead and figure out what the vertex is. So if I want to find the vertex, what am I going to do to find my vertex? Yep. So I have 2 comma blank. So I'm going to plug 2 in for my x value. So I have negative 2 times 2 squared plus 8 times 2 minus 2. 2 squared is 4. 4 times negative 2 is? Negative 8. 8 times 2 is? 16 minus 2. Does that make sense? So let's see. Negative 8 plus 16 is? 8. 8 minus 2 is? 6. So my vertex is where? 2, 6. So let's plot it. 2, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Which direction is this parabola going to open? Down, because the a value is negative. All right. Oh, what's the y-intercept? 0, comma?
Negative 2.
Negative 2. Why is it negative 2?
The c-value
is negative 2. Okay? So where it crosses the y-axis at 0, negative 2. Okay, remember that green line, and there's the axis of symmetry, so it's a mirror. So how far are we away from the mirror right here? 2. So I'm going to go 2 on the right side. Oh, that's okay. That might actually be a point that we need. So 0, comma, negative 2 work there. So if I was 2 away here, then if I go 2 away here, what is this 4 going to be? 4, comma, 1, 2, 3, 4, negative 2. See how they're equal distance from each other? Mm-hmm. Yeah, as soon as you find the vertex, you have things on the right side and the left side that are equidistant, so the same distance. So you just have to determine that. All right, I have 2 points left. I have a 1 and a 3. What's an easier value to plug in?
1.
Everyone with me? So this is an easier value to plug in. So let's plug it in. I get negative 2 times 1 squared plus 8 times 1 minus 2. 1 squared is? 1. 1 times negative 2 is? Negative 2. 8 times 1 is? 8. And then I have that minus 2, right? Okay, let's do the math. Negative 2 plus 8. 6. 6 minus 2 is?
4.
4. So if that's 4, what is this?
4.
Because it's the same distance. That's to the left, that's to the right. So 1 comma 4. So 1 comma 4. And then 3 comma 4. Notice the distance here and the distance here are the exact same. The distance here and the distance here are the exact same. We have enough information to draw out our parabola. So is there anything more to fill in down here? Oh, take a look. Do we have exact values for our roots? It crosses the x-axis. Do I know exactly where that happens? Do I know exactly where this happens? So, roots. I'm going to put a question mark at. So let's do this. My original question is this. So negative 2x squared. Negative 2x squared plus 8x. Well, we have to be careful because irrational numbers will cross the x-axis just like rational numbers. So we don't know. So let's go back to, let's do this. So I am going to factor. I'm going to factor out a negative 2. And that leaves me x squared minus 4x plus 1. Why did those two signs just change? I factored out a negative, okay? What is my magic number I'm going to factor now?
1.
And so it's positive, so these both have to be negative, right? So the factors of 1 are 1 and 1. If I go negative 1 plus negative 1, do I get negative 4? So what did you call this? This was called prime because it didn't factor, right? So if it's prime, we're going to start calling that irrational. Okay, irrational means that we know approximately where we're crossing there, but not exactly. So yes, for our roots, irrational is the answer. So IR.
Would you get it wrong if you
No, but I want to start steering you towards the irrational. Okay? Does that make sense? So it crosses the x-axis, but it doesn't factor. It crosses the x-axis, but it doesn't factor. That means that it's an irrational number. Okay? It also could mean it's a not real number, meaning, but this is definitely irrational. The reason I know this is irrational and not a non-real number or a complex number is it crosses the x-axis. If it crosses the x-axis and I can't see exactly where it is, it doesn't factor, it's irrational right away. How we doing?
Any more?
One more. All right, one more. See how we do. Okay? All right. Is there a value up there that's missing?
The
C value, right? So the C value must be what?
Zero.
Okay. Do you feel this parabola opens up or down? There you go. It opens up. How do I know it opens up? What value is positive? My A value. Okay. So we have to recognize that this is a plus zero. Okay. So we could put it there. Some people are saying, hey, is it zero, zero? You're right. We'll get there. We'll get there. Yeah. Go ahead. I could, and that would direct me to find the roots, which we'll get there. Well, let's find the vertex first. So to find the vertex, I'm going to go negative b over 2a. So negative, what's my b value? What's my b value? Negative 12. Oh, I have a negative negative 12. What do you think is going to happen there? Positive. What is my a value? 3. Negative negative, that's positive. 12 over 6, which is 2. So I'm going to put my vertex right in the middle. So what's a number to the left of 2? 1. What's a number to the left of 1, 0. What's the number to the right of 2?
3.
What's the number to the right of 3?
4.
Okay? So I know my vertex is going to be 2, comma, something. Right? Something. So what should I do with that 2 in order to find out that something?
Plug it in.
So I get 3 times 2 squared minus 12 times 2. What is 2 squared? 4. What is 4 times 3? Then I have negative 12 times 2 is? So 12 minus 24? Negative 12. Do I have 12 boxes? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Shoot. I don't have 12 boxes, so
you
what?
You can create his common factor.
No, no.
You can reduce it.
No, no.
By 2.
No, no.
You can go to 1. Why not?
I need to change my scale factor, so I'm going to count by what would make sense.
Twos.
Count by 2s. Okay? So I'm going to put this, that we're going to count by 2s. Because it's going to be the same vertex. So we're going to count by 2s in both directions. Still with me? Counted by 2s in both directions. Still with me? Counted by 2s. So, ready? 2, right? 2, correct? And then 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, negative 12. Hey, what was my axis of symmetry? What's my axis of symmetry?
2.
X equals 2. So my axis of symmetry is still here. Remember, we called this 2, right? So I'm changing my scale that I'm plotting. Okay, here's my vertex. Remember, we're counting by 2s now. We're not counting by 1s. Make it fit. Okay? What is my y-intercept? 0, 0. Okay, look how far away, that's how many away from the vertex. Then 4, 0, there you go. So I get 0, 0 right here, agreed? And I'm counting by how many? 2, 4, right here. I know some of you are now just starting to look up for the first time. Am I counting my boxes as 1s or 2s? 2s. So remember, this is 2 away, this is 2 away. Even though it looks like on our graph that we're 1 away, we're counting by 2s. Okay? So now I have 1 value left, or 2 values left, which are going to be the same. Which value appears to be easier to plug in, the 1 or the 3? The 1. Okay, 1 squared is? 1. 3 times 1 is? Negative 12 times 1? Okay, so if that's negative 9, what's this one? Okay, help me out though. Help me out, help me out, help me out. We are counting by how many's? 2s. So we're going to be halfway on our boxes, yes? So 1, comma, negative 9. So 1 is right there, negative 9. Negative 2, negative 4, negative 6, negative 8, negative 9 is right there in the middle. Is that okay?
Mm-hmm.
And that's the same thing right here. I'm counting by 2, so 2, bless you. There's my 3, and I'm going to go down negative 9. Negative 2, negative 4, negative 6, negative 8, negative 9. So remember, we counted by 2s. What are my roots? What are my roots as points?
0, 0, 4.
There you go, 0, 0, and 4, 0. Okay, this is way different than what you've seen. It's going to be a lot of the, huh?
What?
Wait a minute, that's different than what we worked on. I know. Okay, so our homework is 4 problems. It is page 77 and 78 of your worksheet. I'll print these up. I'll get you guys some copies, okay? This, I'll bring it to you next class. Cool. It's different. It's different.